So we're continuing with our discussion of covectors. In this video, we're going to talk about covector components. So just a quick review, we said that covectors are functions that take vectors to produce numbers. These functions are linear and obey these properties here. These functions can be added and scaled in a meaningful way, and because of that, they form a vector space, which we called V star. And finally, we can visualize covectors as these oriented stacks of planes. So when I first introduced covectors, I said that they were a bit like row vectors. So we know that a column vector really represents a vector's components in a given basis, right? So that makes you think that row vectors somehow represent a covector's components, and that's exactly correct. So I'd just like to pause here and state this in case it's not already obvious. Covectors, like vectors, are invariant. They are purely geometric objects and they do not depend on a coordinate system. But covector components do depend on the coordinate system. So a covector will be represented by different row vectors with different components depending on which coordinate system we're using. All right, so that aside, what do we even mean when we say that a covector has components? When we write the column vector 2, 1 in reference to a basis here, what we really mean is that this vector is given by the linear combination 2e1 plus 1e2. We're just telling you how much of each basis vector is needed to make the vector. So what are we talking about when we say a row vector 2, 1? Like 2 of what and 1 of what? So remember, covectors are functions from the vector space V to numbers. Covectors don't live in the vector space V, right? They take vectors in V as inputs. So we can't use basis vectors in V to construct covectors. So what do we do? Well, what we're going to do is we're going to take a basis E1, E2 for V, and we're going to introduce two special covectors, epsilon 1 and epsilon 2, which are both functions from vectors to numbers. And you'll notice I've put the labels 1, 2 above the covector instead of below. I did that on purpose, and we'll get to why I did that later. Anyway, these covectors are defined as follows. When epsilon 1 acts on E1, we get 1, and when epsilon 1 acts on E2, we get 0. And when epsilon 2 acts on E1, we get 0, and when epsilon 2 acts on E2, we get 1. So if that's confusing, all this really says is that if the top number matches the bottom number, we get 1, and if the numbers are different, then we get 0. So to sum all this up, we can write epsilon I of EJ is equal to the Kronecker delta IJ. Remember that the Kronecker delta says if I equals J, we get 1, and if not, we get 0. So right here is how we define the epsilons. So what do these covector epsilons actually look like as stacks of lines? So to find that out, let's apply them to a vector. So here's epsilon 1 acting on some vector V, and of course we can write V as a linear combination of basis vectors E1, E2. And remember, since covectors are linear, we can add and scale the inputs or add and scale the outputs and get the same answer. So we can bring the addition and the scaling numbers outside the function like this. And epsilon 1 of E1 goes to 1, and epsilon 1 of E2 goes to 0 by definition. And so we're just left with V1. And we can do the same thing and apply epsilon 2 to V, and we end up with the second component, V2. So what these epsilons are doing is that they're projecting out vector components, right? When we apply epsilon I to V, we get the ith component of V in the E1, E2 basis. So epsilon 1 visually looks like this because it helps us get the first component of V, where E1 is the basis vector that points in this direction. And epsilon 2 looks like this because it helps us get the second component of V, where the E2 basis vector points in this direction. So that's what the epsilon covectors look like. Now let's apply some general covector alpha to V. So this could be any covector we choose. And again, let's expand V in the basis E1, E2 and use the linearity of alpha to get this. Now remember, the components of V can be obtained by applying the epsilons, right? The epsilons project out the components. So we can rewrite alpha of V like this. And what we're going to do now is we're going to make these definitions here. So we define alpha of E1 as the number alpha 1, and we define alpha of E2 as the number alpha 2. So that means we can rewrite this. And using the scaling and addition rules for covector, we can rewrite this sum as a single covector like this. And finally, we get this. So alpha is equal to alpha 1 epsilon 1 and alpha 2 epsilon 2. So what we've done is we've written a general covector alpha, which could be any covector of our choice, as a linear combination of the epsilon covectors. So what this means is that the epsilon covectors form a basis for the set of all covectors. And for that reason, we call these epsilons the dual basis, because they're a basis for the dual space V star. So we've written this out algebraically, but let's try to think of this visually so we have a better idea of what's going on. Say we have a covector alpha, a stack of lines living in a space with basis E1, E2. We can get the components of alpha by applying it to the basis vectors E1, E2. So we're just going to count the number of lines pierced here. And now, using these alphas, we can write covector alpha as a linear combination of epsilon 1 and epsilon 2 like this. So the process is, we start with our vector basis, and then using this definition here, we get the dual covector basis. And then using those, we can express any covector as a linear combination of the dual basis. But remember, these epsilons aren't the only basis we could use to express alpha. We could use any basis that we wanted. So alternatively, we could start with this vector basis, and then using this rule, we can define another dual basis, which are the epsilon tildes, which are these. And we could also express any covector as a linear combination of the epsilon tildes. So there are multiple bases that we can use to express a covector. Up here we have the epsilons, and down here we have the epsilon tildes. Okay, so let's say we have a covector, which is represented in the old covector basis, the epsilons, and has components 2, 1. What would those components look like in the new covector basis, the epsilon tildes? Well, all we need to do is apply alpha to the new basis vectors, E1 tilde, E2 tilde. So let's start working this out. So what's the first component? That's alpha of E1 tilde. Well, looking here, we see that E1 tilde is just 2E1 plus 1E2. And by linearity of alpha, we can do this. And we know how alpha acts on E1 and E2 from up here. These are just the components of alpha in the old basis. And this works out to be 5. And we can do the same thing for the second component. E2 tilde is negative a half E1 and a quarter E2. And we can use the linearity of alpha. And we replace these with the components in the old basis. And we get negative 3/4. So this covector alpha has components 2, 1 in the old dual basis. But it has components 5, negative 3/4 in the new dual basis. And you'll notice that the old and new covector components are related by this matrix, which is the forward matrix. So with covector components, forward brings us from old to new, and backward brings us from new to old. And this is actually the opposite of what we did for vector components under a change of basis. So this is why we can't just flip column vectors on their side to get row vectors. It works in the orthonormal basis, where we can write this yellow vector using 2 E1s and 1 E2. And coincidentally, E1 just happens to pierce 2 covector lines, whereas E2 happens to pierce 1 covector line. So the vector components and covector components are both 2, 1. But in the new basis, we only need E1 tilde to make the vector V, but E1 tilde pierces 5 covector lines. E2 tilde doesn't contribute to the vector V at all, but pierces 3/4 of the way to a covector line in the negative direction. So vector components are measured by counting how many are used in the construction of a vector, but covector components are measured by counting the number of covector lines that the basis vector pierces.